Hi, good morning, Karen. How are
I'm
you?
good, and it's very good to see you on Headstart again. And I wanted to ask you, how are you? How are you doing?
Well, I'm doing well. I'm really humbled and gratified and truly blessed. I've been receiving words of I met also with our presumptive president yesterday, together with Secretary Benny Laguesma. So all is well, all will be well.
All right, can you share with us, I mean, a part of that conversation with presumptive President Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr., what did he tell you?
Well, we cannot go into details, but I think what's important is the overall tone of the conversation, which is that we really should make sure that workers' protection is paramount, and also that we also need to balance that because we are, a player in the global economy, so we have to be conscious of the demands of the supply chain. While making sure that labor rights are not compromised in any way.
Okay. Now, what made you finally decide? You know, what's interesting with your story is your family, in a way, has gone full circle. Your late father, the late Senate President Blas Ople, has actually worked with the late father of Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. He was also Labor Secretary. So it's quite interesting that you are, in a way, continuing your father's work. You have always done it, but the latter part of your life is that's what you're doing. Was that a factor in your decision making?
Well, I can't deny, syempre, Karen, you have to always be conscious of
Legacy.
the legacy, and he's such a huge inspiration for me. So yeah, that weighed heavily in my mind. But what was also gratifying was what Attorney Vic Rodriguez told me when the offer was made. He said, setting aside, the long history between my dad and the president, they were actually looking at my competence
Absolutely.
and also that the years that I have invested in labor migration work. So I found that really gratifying that it was being recognized. So I'm coming in more so as a specialist in my field. And also perhaps also as someone who has a father for her idol throughout her life and would like to do justice to the legacy that he left behind.
And were you concerned in any way when the offer was made? I mean, given the history of the Marcoses in the Philippines, was that a factor to you in your decision making? Kumbaga, nagkaroon ka ba ng agam-agam?
Wala eh. Kasi ang nasa isip ko lang, okay, I've been very open, Karen, that 2 years ago, I had breast cancer, So, I told this to Attorney Vic, our president. So, but you know what weighed also in my mind was what Father Jerry Orbos said. He would say, especially to sa kanyang mga cancer mates, no?
All right, we lost
So,
Toots. Go ahead.
So he said, the rest of your life, the best of your life. So I think I'm at that point where I want to give, the best in me for the sector that I have loved all these years.
Well, I honestly have to say the Marcos administration would be very lucky to have you head. And let's start with this. It's a new department. The Department of Migrant Workers is a new department to have you at the helm. But the problem is it has no money. I'm sure you know that, Toots, right? For
Yes.
2022, I interviewed Congressman Ed Selagman yesterday, and I asked him about that. And Edsa Lagman said he checked, and let me read this. He said there's no funding in the 2022 AGAA for the new OFW department. The law creating the new department was approved after or proximate to the passage of the 2022 AGAA. Let's start with your thoughts on that. Did Mr. Marcos discuss this with you?
Well, we just discussed in broad strokes.
Yeah.
I mean, there's still the presidential proclamation that needs to be completed. But we discussed the general direction of where to take the department. Mm. As to regards the budget, there are really three conditions. This is why this department is so unique.
Yeah.
So you need to have ARR, which was done. We need a staffing pattern approved by the DBM, and I don't know
if
what extent that has been. Yes.
Uh-oh.
And then you need a budget proposal to be approved and included in the GAA of 2023.
Yeah.
Which means that if you complete all of that by January of next year, you'll be, you know, fully operational. The department would be fully operational. But having said that, nothing stops us from working with the agencies already existing.
Yeah.
And putting together a team that would, you know, a segue into the team of the department.
Mm-mm.
So we are looking at that. And
uh-oh,
I have always been able to work with different people in different agencies. So I think I come to this position with an open mind, and I'm willing to work with the transition committee.
Okay, so we have an understanding because it's a new department. Does this mean, Toots, that the Department of Migrant Workers will be above, so the POEA will be under you, the OWA will be under you? How does it work? Can you tell us all what happens to all these agencies?
Yes, when the department becomes fully constituted with a running budget of its own, then the POEA will serve as the backbone. It will no longer exist as POEA.
Yeah.
But its functions, I think most of the personnel who have been working so hard through the years will still be there. And then OWA is attached to the department. And then you will also have programs for the families of the OFWs, which presumptive President Bongbong Marcos has emphasize to me that he is cognizant of the social cost.
Mm.
Yung bang lalaki yung bata na isang magulang wala o parehong magulang wala.
Mm.
And he would also like the department to develop programs to take care of the families.
Uh-oh. So will you be holding office? Will the new Department of Migrant Workers, will it be in the POEA office now? Is that fair to say? Kasi malaki yun eh.
Yeah. Yes, that's the most practical and logical thing to do. Most OFWs are familiar with the POEA.
Mm.
It's strategically located with the MRT there. It's very accessible.
Correct.
Baka we might look into getting a few other rooms in the building that's they used to be occupied by the OTR, but you know, that's something way down the road pa.
Okay. Now, with the years of your work, I've interviewed you many times. You've rescued Filipinos even. I think I was with you in Malaysia one time. I mean, but you've rescued Filipinos from human trafficking. Now that you are an incoming secretary, what change would you do structurally and in terms of policy that will have a big difference in terms of abuse when it comes to our migrant workers, our OFWs, na hindi mo magawa noon because you were not in government?
Yes, I want to change the narrative of the OFW.
Okay.
Right now, hindi pa umaalis ang tingin na sa kanya welfare case. So setting aside the structure, because there are a lot of technical details that would have to go into that.
Yeah.
Yung behavior, I would like them to leave na as dignified as possible, na parang it's an informed choice, not a rash decision. It's an informed choice to be made together with the family. So that mindset I want to bring to the table, and I want to tell them, yung OFWs, you are not, you know, don't see yourself as kawawa, because certainly we don't look at you that way. What we want is all of us are architects of our own economic recovery. So you are part of the economic recovery. Mm-hmm. And the all the stakeholders should treat each other as partners in economic recovery.
Uh-oh. And I'm sure, how do you feel about Mr. Marcos not wanting to return Isabong? Because my sources tell me that it's even affected OFW remittances, the addiction to Isabong.
Well, that has to be evidence-based, ano, yung effects sa remittances. But I know particularly of one family that yung breadwinner, yung tatay, nag-commit ng suicide because of accumulated debts due to Isabong. Because the presumptive president is now the father of the entire nation. Mm. So he would have to look into that. And I would support any decision that he would make. And certainly, I'm sure that he's conscious also of the effect of Isabong, not just to OFWs, but to ordinary workers.
Yeah, definitely. Oo. Now, we are we're a country that exports labor. Of course, it's policy. It's they say that we don't declare it as policy, but the truth is the Philippines is a country that exports labor. Will this, what do you think of this? Frankly speaking, Toots, is this something that the country should embrace already? So structures put in place instead of a certain denialism that we want to create more jobs here, etc. I mean, you get how it's been, right? It's like a push and pull. It's a tug of war the last few years.
Alam mo kasi you use the word denialism, no?
Yeah.
We cannot also deny that labor migration is here to stay. Yeah. Labor mobility, mm-hmm. and there's nothing bad with that.
And that's
people
global.
People go where the jobs are. Mm-hmm. People go where their families will be financially sustained and resilient. Mm-hmm. So it's, labor export policy that's really 70s, no? 80s. Yeah. Right now, you go to the UN and they're talking about migration governance. Mm. Iba na eh. Iba na yung mundo. Mm. We're all part of the global supply chain.
Mm-mm. All right. So siguro ang huling tanong ko lang because we don't have enough time. When you take office, what would your priority be in the 6 months? Of course, Mr. Marcos starts after June 30. So you have 6 months without your own funding. What would you want to do in those 6 months to make sure that in 2023, you're running at full speed?
Yeah, I think it's important that I consult with the stakeholders, that we have a common vision for the department. In NGO parlance, we talk about co-creation in developing projects. I want to have a co-creation phase with our stakeholders, especially the OFW. Second, I want to review all the systems in place. Yeah. Why is it difficult for good employers to get Filipinos in the same way that bad employers sometimes they even have an easier time to get Filipino workers? There's something wrong with the system.
Uh-oh.
So we need a systems review. We also need a performance review. Those who have made it a business to receive gifts, to go out and be,
mahirap yan, ha? Mahirap yan.
But I have to live. I had to lead by example.
Yeah.
Just like my dad did.
Good for you.
Talagang, office, bahay, wala nang socials, trabaho lang. Mm. Yun. And I've been telling people, please watch my back then and let me know. Mamaya, I'm losing my moral compass. Yun ang prayer ko talaga, not to lose my moral compass.
Very good. What an inspiration to listen to you this morning, Toots. And I'd like to say, please keep yourself healthy, keep yourself strong, because you have a lot of work in the next 6 years.
You.
So be strong. Good luck to you and God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Karen.
All right.